Welcome to another edition of Fireside Chats, and I am thrilled on this sunny Friday afternoon to be joined by Kevin Otterson, my frequent collaborator here at AMR.Solutions. Kevin has been working with Kevin now for some years, as you will hear, and he continues to teach me about many, many things in the political and economic world. So welcome, Kevin. Thank you for being here.
Yeah, good afternoon, John.
So I want to start by talking about pull incentives. And the last 10 days have just been wild with activity. And so let's start in the United States, where on Thursday, April 27th, the Pasteur Act was reintroduced. And on Friday, the 28th of April, you sat in front of a congressional subcommittee and gave testimony. Talk to us a little bit about what's going on with Pasteur and why that hearing occurred on Friday the 28th.
Well, a lot of people don't understand is that every 2 years, everything gets wiped out in Congress. You know, the it's a new Congress entirely. And so everything has to be reintroduced if it didn't get passed. So this was the moment in which the folks behind Pasteur decided, do we want to try this again? And they said yes. And so that was the reintroduction. There's a lot of work that happens behind the scenes to get co-sponsors and to see if there's any slight modifications to the language. And all that was done, and it was reintroduced. So that's the first step. You can't pass what's not laid on the table in Congress. So that's a good first step. And then the next day, like you said, a hearing that came something as a surprise to me. And I first heard about it when I received a reach out from staff saying they would like me to consider being a witness. And this was only a week before. And we pulled that all together, really quite quickly.
A fascinating hearing. And it was conducted by the House Energy and Commerce Committee, which always sounds a little bit off to me a little bit. Can you talk about why that committee got behind this?
House Energy and Commerce is absolutely the right committee, because they deal with health issues, and they would be the committee of jurisdiction for the Pasteur Act. They cover Medicare and all sorts of things like that. Mm-hmm. The equivalent of the Senate with the Health, Education, Labor, and Pension, the HELP committee.
Okay.
The unique thing here is that this wasn't the health subcommittee of the House Energy and Commerce. This was an investigations and oversight, which typically you get a request to come testify from them, it's bad news, right? You know, they're digging into something that that they think might be wrong. Here it was driven entirely by just curiosity of the members. It wasn't a legislative hearing. This is an oversight committee. But they were driven remarkably by just wanting to know more.
Wow. Well, listening to it from a distance, it was a very energetic conversation, lots of very insightful questions from the members of the subcommittee. They were clearly very well prepared. I thought the questions they asked were just superb. And the four of you there, so there were four of you on the panel, right? So you were there as a BU professor. We had Amanda Jezik from IDSA. We had Amy Mathers from UVA representing American Society of Microbiology. And then we had Mary Dinigan McCauley, who was representing the GAO. And I'll just call it out, and then I'm going to ask you for your view on the whole thing. But one of my favorite parts of it was you created a new meme for me. I'm just going to say that. The Rusty Bridge. I thought that was a great line about how resistance eats away at antibiotics the way rust eats away at a bridge. We've got to start using that. Maybe I'll come up with a rusty fire extinguisher. I don't quite know what to do with that. So that was outstanding.
I'm just trying to talk about infrastructure that needs maintenance over decades.
Yeah, I thought it was a great line.
Yeah.
Rusty bridges have to be fixed, because otherwise they fall into the river and that makes a mess, and we don't like that. So what was your sense of the way of how it felt to be in the room, and any sort of feedback before, after the discussion? So what was the ebb and flow of it, and any other highlights other than rusty bridges?
You know, there's some awe and fear that's inspired when you stand up in front of the C-SPAN cameras and take the oath.
That was very impressive.
So, it sharpens the mind, shall we say. I want to say something about the GAO testimony. You know, a lot of people watching this may not remember, but there was 2 years of study by the GAO that resulted in a major report that said, amongst other things, we really need pull incentives in the United States. And unfortunately, that report came out at the end of March in 2020. And do you remember what was going on in March of 2020?
I'd rather not remember what was going on.
I was washing my vegetables when we got home from the supermarket wearing hazmat suits. But that report went into that environment and just didn't go anywhere. And in this hearing, because she was requested to come back, GAO released just a couple of days ago, you know, her testimony, which kind of updates that report and brings this report, which I thought was well done.
Yeah.
Finally gives it a little bit of time in the sunlight with the appropriate group of people. So I was happy for that.
Yeah, we'll stick the link below to that report. It is a superb report. And it sounded as if they might be updating the report. Does that seem right to you?
So there was a number of questions from the members of Congress that would seem like it would be good in response to the questions to update some things in the report. But I don't know the formal process. I think Congress has to ask in some formal way. Okay. For them to update a report, but her testimony was released as a GAO testimony, and it's available on the GAO website now as well.
I see. Outstanding. We will find the link to that and stick it in the appropriate newsletter, because that would be worth knowing where to find. So, very positive hearing. Lots of members of the House who are knowledgeable, lots of bipartisan support, because it's been reintroduced in the Senate and in the House, right? We've got two sponsors in the House, two sponsors in the Senate, it's back in. This is the imponderable question. What's your read of the tea leaves? Where are we going?
You know, pasture costs money. And I don't know if you've noticed, but there's a big fight brewing in DC right now on the, you know, extending the budget debt ceiling. Right. Yeah. And so nothing happens until that's fixed. And then secondly, Pasteur has to be really attached to some piece of legislation that's going to move, that will pass. And there's a, you know, one of those lying around, the every 5 years, the reauthorization of a group of agencies within Health and Human Services, including BARDA. The Pandemic All Hazards Preparedness Act. Talk to your favorite lobbyist, I'm not one, about the actual percentage chances of this happening, but I'm told that that's the goal, to attach it to a bill that must pass. And for that to happen really requires, you know, enthusiasm, not just from rank and file members, but enthusiasm from the key committee chairs.
Yeah.
And House Energy and Commerce is one of those key committees.
Okay. So even though the name of House Energy and Commerce, it's never sounded to me like that's where medicine ought to be, but it is. And having had that hearing, getting some jazzed up folks that's what you got to do, you know, and so we as a community have done our bit by making the noise and rattling the cage. And let's now see if the next step can occur. Absolutely amazing.
So, you know, John, you and I have been hammering away at pull incentives for a while. This is the highest watermark, or the most advanced it's ever gotten on this. You know, we have a consensus bill that patient groups and ID doctor groups and industry and neutral arbiters like the Pew Charitable Trust that are all rallying around. We have more co-sponsors than we've ever had. We have the clear support of the White House, as well as it being entirely bipartisan with an equal number of Republicans and Democrats on the bill. And I think this is the first hearing in which any amount of it was devoted to talking about subscription models or the Pasteur Act. Mm-hmm. And so this is, you know, it takes a long time to get anything done in D.C. and everything seems impossible until suddenly it's accomplished. And we're making steps forward.
Yeah, extraordinary. And speaking of taking steps forward, meanwhile, on the other side of the Atlantic.
Same week.
How can all this occur simultaneously? We have just a mind-boggling piece of legislation proposed by the European Commission.
Go European Commission. Yeah, they came out with a broad pharmaceutical package. It's part of their, major, once every couple decades sort of revamping of pharmaceutical legislation in Europe. And lots of things in there. But one of the important things is a very clear package of pull incentives, a short, medium-term solution, and then a longer-term solution would really put Europe on the map in terms of a significant, powerful pull incentive.
Boy, howdy. So there's a newsletter that I put out that summarized it. So essentially, it's a two-step dance. There's an initial step of creating transferable data exclusivity vouchers. And then there's a longer-term step of getting the member states to do procurement sort of after the manner of the UK pilot or the Pasteur Act. And transferable exclusivity vouchers are something that we've talked about for a number of years. You've written about them. You've written about the sort of the good, the bad, and the ugly of transferable exclusivity. And, Drive AB spent a lot of time on that. So give us a little commentary on transferable exclusivity and why the European Commission started there as opposed to someplace else.
The latter part is that it's the thing that's most closely within the power or authority or competence of the Commission, competence in a legal term.
Yeah.
So, the Commission can't, at a central level across all the member states in Europe, they can't change basic health legislation. That belongs to the member states. They can do things, though, with patents and with data exclusivity on drugs. That is a competency that's been given to the Commission, to the central government, across the whole union. So, one of the advantages of this idea, which is basically, you bring an amazing antibiotic to market that meets standards, you get the certificate, you take this golden ticket, you can use it or sell it, and it applies to other drugs, not antibiotics, but other drugs that are making money. And you extend delayed generic entry by a year. Back in 2007, I wrote an article highly critical of this idea. one of the quotes in that article was that you're taxing heart disease to pay for antibiotics. In 2016, I wrote a second article on it and said I actually rethought that comment. And I think actually that taxing, the rest of the health system to fund the infrastructure that is antibiotics is the right idea. There's still lots of efficiency problems and things that have to be done with vouchers. There's an interesting paper from French economists that won the Nobel Prize at the Toulouse School of Economics, thinking about ways to make the exclusivity voucher more efficient. And there's still many unanswered questions. There's a lot of people in Europe that don't like this idea passionately. But clearly it's something the Commission can do. And then the second idea that you mentioned requires the 27 member states to all agree carefully and thoughtfully with lots of discussion to line up in the same direction and do something similar with national legislation across 27 countries. So everyone recognizes that will take time. And what's interesting about this proposal is here's the voucher that we can do now. Mm-hmm. And we're going to do 10 of these over the next 15 years. Mm-hmm. And then meanwhile, we're going to be working on the long-term solution, 27 member states all pointing in the same direction, doing something similar that looks like a subscription or a revenue guarantee model. But we know that'll take a number of years.
Like a decade, yeah.
It might, things take long, just like in DC, right? Things take long.
Yeah,
but you put it together, and you have a short-term solution that phases out once the long-term solution is in place.
You know, they're giving themselves the same kind of runway that the U.S. has had. I mean, if you will, you know, the serious work on the ideas behind Pasteur, well, it was two Congresses ago. Was it three? Two or three? And before there was some other stuff before, you know, well, we did GAIN, and then which gave us QIDP. And so we've been in the U.S. sort of banging away at various kinds of incentives for a decade. And, you know, the European Commission really started to talk about it in public in the last couple of years. So this is, you know, it takes time to work it through your political system. You know, if I think about, you know, the UK did it in almost, we'll call it blindingly fast. I think they did it in about 7 or 8 years from the start of the UK AMR review in 2015 to having the subscriptions going, having the first two products in their pilot. So it does take time. And it actually, writing about that reminded me that it's currently the Swedish presidency, this block of time from January to June of this year. And the first time that you and I met, even though we didn't even know to say hello to each other, was in 2009, when the Swedes were the presidents of the EU, and they had that amazing workshop about innovative incentives for antibacterials that led to TATFAR and the declaration by the EC they're going to do something, and led to the creation of new drugs for bad bugs, led ultimately to the creation of Drive AB, which caused the two of us to meet and actually know each other at that point, as opposed to just standing in the same room. What an extraordinary sleigh ride. Absolutely amazing.
That sleigh ride in Sweden. There wasn't any snow on the ground at that meeting. But I don't know if you remember the, and I'm going to mess up her name, but the princess or crown princess of Sweden.
She came, that's right.
Giving that speech with no notes, and there wasn't a teleprompter, to a room full of you know, a couple hundred, you know, AMR nerds like you and me. And she gave a substantive speech on the threat of antimicrobial resistance from heart, you know, from just knowing the issue, which I thought was an impressive royal family display of caring about an issue and following through. Yeah. So, yes, it's wonderful that Sweden once again holds the presidency of the Council of the European Union. A couple more months, I guess.
Yeah, well, and you know, bully for them for getting it on the agenda, and yeah. It'll take whatever time it takes at this point to make it go forward, but getting it on the agenda is step number one. And you know, the fact that the bureaucrats, the thinkers at the commission sat down and worked this through and said, we're not going to just wring our hands. We're not going to just moan and groan and have another call to action that goes nowhere. We're going to take a pragmatic, measured step and do the experiment. You know, my hat's off. It's just fantastic to see that happen. And we will learn. You know, the UK pilot has taught us an enormous amount, and it's lovely to see the criteria sort of aligning up. The three criteria that they proposed were novel mechanism, the novel chemical entity, I think, and activity against resistant infections. But they lined up very much with the principles of the UK thing. And that's great. We need a common set of principles, sort of a common target profile. So just absolutely amazing to see that come about.
I just want to say with UK, we're going to get UK 2.0 this summer and into the fall. We'll hear announcements coming out of UK on how they've looked at and applied their lessons learned, and we'll see what sort of modifications they make. But you're right, that's important information to the rest of the world who are thinking about pull incentives. And it was great to see entry standards or eligibility standards articulated at a high level in the European proposals. And you're right, they are concordant with what's in the Pasteur Act, with what the UK has done, and we'll see what the modifications are. You know, folks are actually learning from each other, which is important because we need, you know, all of the G7 plus other places to sign onto these pull incentives to really make the meaningful difference that we all wanted to have here.
Yeah, and as you recently observed, at this point, all of the G7 is actively poking at this problem.
Japan made their announcement April 1st. We'll hear more at the G7 meeting in Hiroshima or Nagasaki. Japan is hosting G7 this year. Canada has publicly announced this commission that you and I serve on to come up with help Canada think through antibacterial pull incentives. U.S., you have the PASTEUR Act and this hearing. Europe, which covers, Italy, France, Germany, as well as the other 24 members of the union, put their proposal out last week. So yes, that's from an idea that had no government in support of it when we were talking about it in Drive AB, to every member of the G7 either adopting it or putting serious proposals on the table.
That's spectacular.
I call that progress.
Yeah.
I know it's not fast enough, and that, I feel for the companies who are trying to make payroll and thinking about how they do things next year. If governments don't get their act together and things go on another year or two, that's just companies that will never know their names that will die.
Yeah. Well, and speaking of companies, I want to close with a discussion of the CARB-X annual report. Knock my socks off. You guys have been at this now for
7 years almost.
7 years. And the number of products supported is over 100, I believe.
Well, it's a 92, and then we have a bunch of rounds that are in process right now. And we haven't made any announcements on those rounds yet.
Right. And linked to that, again, this last 10 days, you can't believe all this stuff. We have the approval of the first microbiome product, which I know that you've actually supported the company that has that product, the Seres Therapeutics and their product. I'm going to mispronounce it, VOWST, VOWST. Speak a little bit about it.
I think VOWST was easier to say than the non-proprietary version of the name for that product. But that's Series 109 was the old number for that. And CARB-X has supported a follow-on product, Series 155, which is also microbiome, but is more broadly aimed at people that are undergoing, their immune systems are compromised because they're undergoing cancer therapy or other similar therapies. But 109 was focused on recurrent Clostridium difficile or C. diff. I forgot, what is the... It's not new now, but Clostridioides difficile?
Clostridioides, I believe.
Always miss an entire syllable when I say that.
Right.
But, this is an idea that, has been worked on for a while. I remember first being introduced to this in the about a decade ago when the poop pills, were making headlines in the New York Times, or Marty Blaser, who became the chair of the PACCAR, wrote his book, Missing Microbes. But I think the history goes back way earlier than that.
Yeah. The earliest paper that I know of is from 1989. And I say I've not done a super deep dive to go. There may be earlier stuff than that, but I recall being impressed some years ago with this little bitty case vignette in The Lancet. First author's last name is Bennett, B-E-N-N-E-T, who basically was writing about himself. He'd had ulcerative colitis for 7 years. And he arranges to give himself a fecal transplant, and he's suddenly better. And I just remember being struck by the notion that there's something, ought to be something in that. And clearly now, and it also says something about 1989. So that's 30 years ago, 34, 35 years ago. And how long it takes to bring new products forward.
So, I know the 89 paper is an N of one, but still, it rang a bell for some people. And then all sorts of work funded by people like the NIH, and then lots of companies started and whatnot. And here we are in 2023, last week, that amazing week, and we get the first actual, this is a Pathfinder, this first approval. And there's a number of other companies behind, you know, Vedanta's got a phase three product that we've also supported at Carvex, also against C. diff, and there's lots of other microbiome things coming from various companies. But it's great to see a path breaking first across the finish line, and then here comes, you know, a lot of innovation that will follow on. It's a beautiful thing, right? We should. How long has it been since we've had something radically new? A long time. So
they don't come along very often.
What a week!
Yeah. What a week!
So congratulations to the series team and also to all the other teams will have approvals in the next, you know, year or two or three. You know, good work over the past two or three decades.
Yeah, we stand on the shoulders of giants. I mean, there's been all that work that's gone into proving that was even possible, that you could describe it, that you could define it. What an extraordinary set of events. Well,
I'm sure you're going to get comments from somebody saying, oh, you missed this other amazing thing from last week.
I can't keep up. It really was exceptional. And so I'm just, you know, thanks for hopping on the call with me, because it seemed like this just called for a fireside chat. We've all been blindingly busy, but I really did want to make time to have this conversation. And again, thank you for going down to that hearing. That was, if you've not listened to the hearing, this is speaking to people who might be watching this, it's really fun. It's 2 hours long. Sit through it and just sort of soak it up. Really a fantastic conversation for you to listen to. Well, that's all I got for the day. You got anything else you want to talk about?
I think that... you know, we're at a real cusp. We're at a moment here. There's a lot of momentum, and I know people get tired of hearing that we're close. But this is not a moment for us to lose heart or to give up. We have an amazing first approval. We have all sorts of, you know, I mean, Carvex today has 9 projects that therapeutics that we have supported. That are in clinical trials.
Yeah.
This moment. Okay. In 2016, Carvex was an idea that you and I were talking about.
We thought we might get we were going to get 5 products funded in the first year? Something like that.
So, you know, I'm just saying over time things can happen.
Yeah.
And I'm really, you know, personally as an academic, deeply supportive to this agenda of getting a Pollen Center, because I want something there that the little company that you and I have never heard of, that mm-hmm. that they are 10 or 15 or 20 years away from an FDA approval, mm-hmm. for them to actually have some possibility of getting funding and their investors mm-hmm. seeing that as something that will cause them not to go bankrupt, you know. Mm-hmm. That would be a positive story, because there's all that unknown science out there needs to be have a chance to move forward. It's amazing stuff. So
absolutely. What was your quote earlier? Everything seems impossible until it happens. And you know, and here we are, actually delighted with stuff that we might not have thought was possible. It actually has occurred. Yeah. Okay. Well, Professor Otterson, it's good to chat with you. Thank you. And enjoy your weekend. We'll be in touch. Safe travels.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Well, what fun to spend a bit of time chatting with Kevin this afternoon about the extraordinary events of the past, from my perspective, 14 years, since that Swedish conference in 2009 to all of the events of the last week. Just can't keep up with that collection of stuff. What a treat. So thank you for tuning in. And as always, like, comment, and subscribe for more. See you next time.